I will focus on the new products and on, especially because we are here for CAR-T, the new products from Kite and Novartis. So we have three key objectives. We have the collaboration with EBMT, EMA and Pharma. You already heard the registry and Owen, and if you are the third one to talk, you always have to find something else to add. So I can tell you that in the meantime that the process with EMA was developed, we put an initiative at EBMT that we put around the table the pharma. The pharma are committed to EBMT and they want to use our registry for their long-term follow-up of the patients. Further, I will go into a little bit the cell therapy registry, but also put some pressure on what is in the EMA form and which role you would have to make this a successful exercise. The role of the data manager is totally underestimated in science. If you have the best product, you have the best physician, the best center in Europe, but you do not have a data manager who puts the data into a registry and your data, your patients are not registered or incomplete registered, results can be biased enormously. So I will give you some examples later. So complete data reflects the real outcome of the patient. We have new cell therapy products. These are promising products tested in phase one or phase two. It's a low number. It's around 7,500 patients in the Kymriah and in the Kite setting. The severe advance reporting is done and obligatory. It goes directly to the pharma. Because the promising results are and responses are based on the low numbers, EMA gives earlier approval than normally. Normally, you would have a part three study on the products with randomization. But because these products comes to the market, they do not want to withhold this from the patients. They say, okay, we replace this by performing a post-authorization safety study. We are working with EMA, as Owen showed, and I just point out the aspects which are important for you. The centers will be selected by the pharma. Probably you heard that your physicians were very stressed because Bluebird Bio, Kite, Novartis visit your center. Selected your center or not yet selected your center, they had a lot of demands on the hospital infrastructure, and most of the cell therapy centers who are now, let's say, the centers of excellence within EBMT, the startups with the CAR-T, are inspected by multiple pharma. This means that you as data manager will also work with multiple past studies using different products. Every product has his own questions, but in generally, let's say 95% of those questions we put in a form. There was consensus about it. So we hope that with the form we have now that we can collect most of the data. Because the product is manufactured in the pharma factory, there is a delay in treatment. Patients are registered at the moment of apheresis. If they have a transplant, they get a relapse. You do an apheresis, you send the product to the manufacturer. There is a delay in treatment, so probably the patient will get some treatment for bridging until the product is coming back. We hope, and we really discussed this extensively with pharma, we hope that we can track and trace the first CAR-Ts in the next 2 years around, that as soon as the pharma receives the product from your center, the center knows what to do. The farmer sends it back, give a signal to EBMT, and we can track and trace with you. We heard Heidelberg, you will do a CAR T cell in the next few days because the product from Novartis, Kite, Celgene, Bluebird is sent to your facility. The severe adverse event reporting is still a part EBMT will not do in respect to the regulatory obligations, so we will not do the reporting in 24 hours, 7 days and 15 days. But as Carmen already pointed out, we have a lot of complications, which I will show later, which can be reported at the time you are looking at the patient's file and at the patient form. Long-term follow-up is requested, and until now, people talk about long-term follow-up 5 or 10 years. If you look to plots in acute leukemia, 5 to 10 years is the maximum. In EBMT, we have some projects on long-term outcome, but it's very difficult because the follow-up is often stopped after a few years. EBMT would like to support a very active data collection, so a very intense role for the data manager in this process. So we would like, we would like to collect the data, and not only the data of the patients, but really the data of all consecutive patients. So if patients are indicated an intention to treat for CAR T, we hope that it would be an option for you, if it is after a transplant, that you can say, okay, this patient, the apheresis is done, and we are now waiting for the product coming back. We focus on complete data, including the long-term follow-up. How to collect this data? Well, as you see, I put the data manager in the middle, because you as data manager are in the position. You have access to the patient file. You have access directly with the physician doing CAR T. So if you have questions about the form, you cannot find the information, you can ask the physician. You are able to register the data and the follow-up and then put it in the registry. As Carmen already pointed out, we will start with the collection on day 100, day 0, day 100, 6 months, 1 year, and then annually. And I put also a point on the slide. The informed consent for long-term follow-up. Because we are now in the process that we include in 5 years a few hundred patients per product, that if the last patient is coming in, we still have to do 15 years follow-up. So these are processes of 20 years. Knowing that new products coming to the market, not all at the one time, but it's in a wave. We have now the first two marketed products. We expect next year another two or three. So even if we are in 3-4 years later, we have still 20 years of follow-up from the market authorization holder then coming to the market. We have the new cellular and gene therapy form. I just focus a little bit to take you what is basic information. It's very important at day zero that we know which type of product you are using. The previous treatments before the gene and cell therapy, basic information about the cells, and also the status of the patient is very important. We have a lot of toxicities. You know, CAR T is a very promising treatment, but it brings also along a lot of toxicities. And what we did in the old days is that we had the Med A, you could say we have infections, we have no infections, but the real infections were put on Med B. So we put in a lot of toxicities, but it's also good to know that if it is a no, you just tick no, you go to the following question. If it is a yes, we ask the date of onset, the grading, the system you use for the grading. If it is treated, as Carmen pointed out, we also collect the treatment of the complication, and of course, if it is resolved or not. So it's a long list, but eventually, hopefully, the patient will only suffer for one or two of those complications. Another point is the infections. The same story, we have infections now described more in extent on the MetB form. For the CAR-T, it's put at EMA level on the EMA form, and it's also important there that we collect, is the infection there, yes, no, the date, and again, which pathogen and the treatment of it. Then we come to the status of the patients after the cell therapy. We have the time points. Is there post-treatment given? It could be, we are now talking about one CAR-T, but in the future, I already heard that there are intentions that if you relapse again, that a new CAR-T could be given. So what are the post-therapy treatments? Very important, the relapse, the nice complications like pregnancies, and the worst complications like secondary malignancies are very important, because this is a part which should be followed up by sample sizing in the pharmaceutical industry. Follow-up and its use. We can do a lot with follow-up, and we can use it in a good way, and it can be used in a bad way. It depends on how much information we have on the survival status and the complication. If we look in the database and you look to MetB data, which is around 25-30%, depending on the disease, you will find the start of the cell therapy, some complications like the cytokine release syndrome, a relapse, and a death. For another patient, you would find a neurotoxicity, an infection. Patient recovered from the infection and is alive. However, all of you are now and aware of missing follow-up. There are different situations. If events like, we call it intermediate events, like infections and neurotoxicity, are not reported at all, we start, we have a life, death, maybe a relapse, but the intermediate is not reported. We call this missing information. If the follow-up is incomplete, this can be looked at two ways. If the analysis is too early and the follow-up is longer than the patient, or if patients are lost to follow-up, then we call it incomplete information. I use some slides from Simona Jacobelli to point out that in this case we have one neurotoxicity and a death. In this case, the patient has a cell therapy and he died almost at 5 months. There are no reports of any event, so we only know, hopefully, the cause of death. In this patient, we have one infection at a rather late time point and a last follow-up. So we can say, if the secondary events are missing, the incidence of the events, if we would like to look at how much neurotoxicity is occurring in patients, we see only one neurotoxicity in three patients. The probability of survival event-free, all those events are events. So if the events are not reported, it seems like that the patient is event-free. Incomplete and short follow-up. If the end of study is earlier, we have a nice reporting of the patient with cytokine release syndrome, with a relapse, but at the point of 5 months, the analysis is done. We know that the patient died later, but the patient is alive at the moment of 5 months. The next one, still, he died. We do not know the reason. So due to a short follow-up of the first patient, it looks like this patient is alive. If we have lost to follow-up, I put a little bit more years, you have patients who are seen alive at month 66. The end of the study is at 8 years, and for EMA we have to follow up 15 years, so the end of the study, of course we have interim analysis, but the end of the study will be 15 years, and we are, let's say, a little bit scared that patient will be lost to follow up due to several reasons. But you can see if you have censored patient being alive at 66 months, the patient died later, this is not reported, this again, it seems that this patient is alive. The survival time is known. It's not completed, but it's known. If you have a patient who died at 40 months, the event is death 40 months. If it is censored and alive at 60 months, you know that the time to death is longer than 60 months. This type is called censoring. Censoring is a nice way to include all your patients you collected, but it has also pitfalls in it. The green line is a theoretical curve of all patients in time dying, and you can see even with an average number of censoring that the black curve is above the green curve, because at the moment you censor a patient, the curve is at the same level. It does not drop. It only drops when an event occurs. In an overall survival, the event is death, so as soon as a patient died, the curve will drop. Consequences of censoring and the impact. You see two examples, the green one with only 20% censoring, so a lot of patients are still follow-up, eventually they die, the curve drop, but at 5 months you can see how much survival there is. If you look at 2 years, you will see that the green curve with 20% censoring has a survival of around 11%. If you have a huge number of censoring and also in the beginning of the curve will drop due to the death, but also due to the short follow-up, the curve will be higher than the initial curve should be because of the censoring. The next point, also due to follow-up, and which is very important, and this is why I stress you to, if you have done your day zero, your 3 months and 6 months, not to relax back, because it's very, very important for all the patients, but also for the pharma, for EBMT, for scientific purposes. EBMT has intentions. If EMA asks to compare products, to compare academic to products, that we can do a good statistical analysis. So, in the over-interpretation of the tail, this means that, this means that at the end of the curve, you see in the first year, in the green group, 40 patients died or are censored, and this is a huge amount. So this means that because they are alive at the moment of follow-up, the curve cannot drop. They are alive. So you get, as they call this, a nice plateau. But if you look at the tail and the numbers, there are only, in the green curve, only a few patients. Normally, statistically, we would say at least 5 patients in the tail, otherwise you cannot draw the curve. It's just to show you what can happen if you have complete follow-up, where all the events are registered, and when you have patients alive, not follow-up, where you presume, looking at the curve, that the survival is better. I put four curves together just to see the effect of the first one is complete follow-up, the very early censoring. It's even show that the curves are more or less equally. If you then compare with the complete follow-up, there's a wrong interpretation. If you have a high censoring or if you have an average censoring. And you can see that the average censoring, which is normal in registries, is more or less equal to a complete follow-up. One conclusion. If we have complete follow-up, eventually the curves will meet or come together and you have a low p-value, but still it's not significant. If you have patients with early censoring, the curve drops, but then the follow-up is not done. Patients are alive, not follow-up, and you see that there's there again a plateau, and if you look at it, it could be that the black curve is better, and this is also shown in the p-value, which is significant. So what is your role as data manager? I think that your job is underestimated. I already talked for many, many years that the data manager should have a central position because you are the link between the patients and the registry. You are the one who can get all the data. You have access to the patient file. You get the patient's data into the registry. So you are the key person. You are the one who decides, do I do the complete form? Am I tired? Am I going home? I complete the form. It's last follow-up. Okay, it's fine. Next day, you come in again and you see the pile of files. You go on. So I want to stress that follow-up is really a need for patients because complete registrations benefits the patient's outcome, but also the future. So if you would be a patient in the future, you would like to know from your physician the real survival and not the interpretation of curves with a lot of censoring. Which options do we have to get complete follow-up? We try to put it in a positive way. So we would like to have an intensive contact between the PAS office in Leiden and the data manager centrally. At least at the start, we will work with maybe 30, 40 centers. So we will get to know each other in the coming years. We have macro. You get access to the EMA specific cell therapy form. And the macro system is an interactive query system, so the reporting now is done with separate mails, separate Excel files, but in macro we can put queries in, it pops up at your screen when you log in, you answer them, it pops up at our screen when we log in and we see what you have done in the meantime. Please report all the events when they occur. So if there's a neurotoxicity, cytokine release syndrome, infections, please score them as soon as possible. Do not wait. Just put them in the database. We put 3 months, 6 months, and a year. But if you have an infection after 30 months, nobody stops you for reporting this infection at 30 months. From the industry, we are negotiating per patient fee. So if you do multiple products and you are one of the centers who maybe do 10 or 20, there is a per patient fee available. So depending on what your institute would do with this money, it would be possible maybe to put a data manager beside you to help you complete this. And another point which EBMT is stressing, we like to build education in training so that the data managers get more expertise in CAR-T, and also more expertise in what they are doing, and also the awareness of how important their job is. We have a long-term follow-up, and this means also a long-lasting commitment, not only for the patient, who rather forgets what he what happened, but also for the centers, because if you are one of the centers with the pass and the products, you are also committed to the 15 years. The pharma has 15 years, they do not have much experience with long-term follow-up, so our registry is the ideal platform to use for that. And for EBMT, we do this already for more than 40 years, so we would be able to do this for the next 40 years as well. I would like to acknowledge Simone Jacobelli, who shared some slides with me. This is my disclosure, I have nothing to disclose. Are there any questions?
Thank you very much, Anja. We are a little bit late, but we started late as well. So we have time for one question.
Now, these are facts we have to, let's say, put in a side contract with the centers, that the center who did the CAR-T will follow up with the peripheral hospital where the patient is, so that there is a yearly contact or maybe a six-monthly contact when complications can be registered. And I presume that if a secondary malignancy or pregnancy occur, they will notify you. So, and the same for relapse. So the main endpoints will be done, but we really would like to stress also the in between the intermediate events to be reported as much as possible.
Carmen.
Just because of what this question is, yeah.
There is a per patient fee, and the hospital decides how this per patient fee will be shared.
I think this is a very, very tricky question, but it's the responsibility lies with the company to collect this data. EMA has given an mandatory for the treatment center, for the company to get the data from the treatment center. If the patient moves, it's very tricky, responsibility is with the company. So if the company then wants that data, well, you know, then they might have to make that contract with the center where the patient moves, or force the center giving the therapy to split the fee. It's a tricky one, and it's probably going to be solved differently in different countries, because the competent authority in the UK might look at this slightly different than the competent authority in France or in the Netherlands or in Spain. So I don't think there will be a one-size-fits-all solution to it. Okay, thank you very much. Coffee break, back in.